Being a private investigator means two things. You can be sure you'll run into trouble, and you can never be sure you'll get out of it. Not much you can do about it, I guess, except, like Julie always says,
walk softly, Peter Troy.
And now Peter Troy investigates the Garrulous Gal.
I think it was Confucius or Khayyam. Anyway, some wily bird once summed up the battle of the sexes in these succinct words. A man chases a girl until she catches him. There's a lot of truth in that, though the gals, of course, don't agree. Julie, my maid of all work, will argue about it until she's blue in her pretty face. But then all I have to do is to look into my files and bring out the dossier on the case of the Garrulous Gal. And, brother, there's all the proof you need. The Garrulous Gal in question was one Cora Donovan. She had many assets, and all of them in the right places. But there was one big disadvantage to Cora. She could talk.
So I told her, and believe me, I told her frankly, Jane, I said, that's not the answer to your problem.
And talk?
Get out and see life, meet people, have yourself a ball.
And talk.
Anyway, I think she's taken some notice of me. She's changed her hairdo, and she wasn't at home when I rang on Thursday, so perhaps
Cora.
She's taken the hint after all. I hope so. Life will be so much more interesting for her.
Cora,
after
baby.
After all, she's not unattractive, is she? And... oh, did you say something, Martin, darling?
I just wanted you to put the brakes on for 1 second.
Oh, I was talking again, huh?
And how?
Sorry.
That's okay, but... oh, never mind.
I said I'm sorry.
I know.
Well, it's only that I always seem to have so much news to pass on to you, darling. There's always so much to tell you.
Only one way to stop you, Cora.
That I like.
I love you.
And you'd love me a whole lot more if I talked just a little less. Well?
You know I couldn't love you any more than I do. Oh, it's like a disease with me, Cora.
Good.
You vixen.
And you want to make me happy?
Of course.
Then help my brother Jack to get an interview with Marshal Prakartis.
Oh, Cora.
You can do it. You know you can do it. He's to be your house guest.
He'll be here on a state visit.
And if Jack could get an exclusive interview with him, he'd get that promotion at the newspaper. Please, Martin.
Oh.
Please. For me.
Beware the tigress when she assumes the guise of the lamb. Confucius or Khayyam again, I think. Anyway, the tigress in this instance had played the game with all the skill at her disposal. Martin Wallace had pursued her until she'd caught him in her web of fascination. But recapping on the situation as it stood, Wallace was a widower and a member of the diplomatic corps, an important member. He'd been instrumental in arranging the state visit of Marshal Prakartis, benign dictator of a small European country, which couldn't make up its mind as to where its loyalties lay. Prakartis was pro-Western in sympathy, and he held sway over his ministers, some of whom had leanings in the opposite direction. Well, the spheres of higher diplomacy and international politics were completely lost on me, until I received a visit from Colonel Llewellyn from the Foreign Office.
It's imperative that Marshal Prakartis's visit is a success, Mr. Troy. He must be made to feel welcome. When the time comes for him to go home, he must be made to realize that he has firm friends here in this country.
Is there any reason why his visit shouldn't be a success, Carl?
Yes, unfortunately, there is. In the past 5 years, there have been 4 attempts on his life. The last time, the assassin's bullet lodged less than 2 inches from his heart.
And you think there'll be another attempt whilst he's here in England?
Well, there could be. There's more than a remote chance. You see, there are agents and sympathizers from the other side here in London. They may already have received their orders.
Yeah, okay, but you'll be taking security measures.
Oh, yes, of course.
Well, then I don't quite understand the purpose of your visit.
Ideally, we'd like Marshal Prakartis to stay at some well-guarded hotel whilst he's here. But unfortunately, the Marshal's a stubborn and uncompromising man. He has a friend in the diplomatic corps called Martin Wallace.
Oh, and he wants to stay with Wallace.
Exactly.
So?
Well, Wallace is a good man, but... you repeat nothing you hear in this office, I trust?
If I did, I'd be out of business, Colonel.
Good. Well, Mr. Troy, Martin Wallace has become, involved, as it were.
Oh, skirt trouble, huh?
I beg your pardon?
He's involved with a lady.
Oh, yes, yes. Seems completely infatuated by a Miss Cora Donovan. Now, he's a widower and very susceptible.
Mm-hmm.
Normally, Wallace is a level-headed individual, well aware of his responsibilities. But lately...
Yeah, I see.
The woman in question seems harmless enough, but we can take no risks. Neither can we instigate an official inquiry into her background. Well, for obvious reasons, of course. So now you can see where you fit in.
You want the dope on the gal.
Yes. And we want her kept away from Wallace whilst the Marshal's in England.
I get it. Well, in order to make the job a little easier, I'd have to have access to Wallace's house.
Yes, well, we've taken that into consideration. You see, Wallace will be requiring more household staff whilst the Marshal's with him. We're planting two of our men as butlers, but he needs two more people. A chauffeur and an assistant cook. We suggest you should fill the former position.
And my secretary becomes the assistant cook.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, she'll love that. Takes her all the time to boil an egg.
Then you'll take on the assignment?
Yep, we'll be there.
Good, then I'll make the final arrangements.
Incidentally, do I have a contact man?
Oh, yes, you do. And Inspector Caswell will be in charge of the special detail bodyguard. You'll work in with him.
Does Caswell know that?
Yes.
Well, didn't he object to working with me?
Well, yes, as a matter of fact, he did. Any friction between you two?
Oh, just a little. About enough to start a four-alarm fire.
That you, Cora?
Yes, Jack.
Well, what happened?
What do you think?
He bit you?
Of course.
Splendid.
He thought of me as a chattering, scatterbrained female, anxious to help her kid brother get on in the world. You will be allowed to go to Wallace's house to interview the Marshal.
Good.
Your orders came through?
Yes, it's what we expected.
The Marshal is to die?
Yes.
How?
The whole affair will go off with a big bang. Figuratively, literally. I shall leave my briefcase behind. Inside, there'll be a nitro time bomb.
Well, how can you be sure the Marshal will be close to it when it goes off?
It'll be identical to the one he owns himself.
They think of everything, don't they?
Yes, and they don't expect us to fail.
We won't.
You know anything about the security arrangements?
Oh, usual precautions. Bodyguards all over the place.
How ludicrous. Do they expect an assassin to creep in at dead of night?
I should imagine some of the servants will probably be security men.
Or they won't interfere with a bona fide newspaper man.
Who is in the place at the direct invitation of Mr. Martin Wallace himself.
I don't like it. I don't like it one little bit.
I agree. The setup is rather dicey.
No, I wasn't thinking about that. I was thinking about you, wondering whose bright idea it was to bring you in on this.
They have problems with the lady, Inspector. They think of Peter Troy as being something of a specialist in these sort of cases.
Personally, I think it's rather nice to be working for the government.
They don't know you like I do.
Jealousy will get you nowhere.
Here they come.
Yeah, sounds as though they're not taking chances even at this stage of the game.
Usual police escort and outriders. All right, you'd better make yourself scarce.
Not me, old boy. I want to take a gander at this gal Wallace has in tow.
Now, Troy.
My orders,
you're
Inspector.
Incorrigible, Troy. Absolutely incorrigible.
Oh, don't tease him, Pete. Things are hard enough for him as it is.
Julie, our dear old chum, the Inspector, takes a delight in being in a perpetual state of indignation. Well, let's take a look at the entourage out there. It's a good view from this window.
Well, Wallace will be in the first car with some Foreign Office bods.
Mm-hmm.
And then comes Marshal Procartis in the second car, followed by Inspector Caswell's boys in the last one.
Mm-hmm.
Have you spotted Cora Donovan yet?
Yeah, she was riding in Wallace's car.
There goes the police escort.
Riding in his car. She must have the poor fool completely under her thumb. Fancy allowing her to ride in an official car during a state function.
I think it's rather sweet.
What?
It's like declaring his love for her to the whole wide world.
Oh.
Well?
She shouldn't be riding in official cars. It makes our jobs just that much more difficult. Who's the fella in the light gray suit beside her?
He's got a press card stuck in his headband.
Well, nobody told me about any newspaper men coming here.
They're all coming in now anyway. I'd better get down to the kitchen.
Troy, they're coming into the house now, so you'd better...
Inspector, there's a pressman out there in Wallace's car. I wasn't told...
That's all right. He's been cleared. Cora Donovan's brother. He's got special permission from Wallace to interview the marshal.
Oh, has he? Well, I still...
What the devil?
Good grief. Somebody's trying to kill the marshal right now. Suddenly, from outside, there was a staccato noise of gunfire. The inspector and I rushed outside, revolvers drawn. Luckily, Wallace and the marshal had already gone inside when the hidden sniper had opened up on the entourage. Security men were already converging on the spot where the marksman must have been, a vantage point close by the entrance of the driveway. As far as we could ascertain, only one person had been hit by the assassin's bullets, and that person was Jack Donovan, Cora's brother. He was helped into the house by Inspector Caswell and one of his men. Naturally, in the excitement, they forgot about searching the innocent-looking briefcase he had with him. And who could blame them? After all, someone had just tried to kill Marshal Prakatis, and on English soil. Everybody was very angry about it.
How's your brother now, Miss Donovan?
Oh, he's fine, thank you. It was only a scratch, really. But it shook him up quite a bit. And, of course, there is the chance of blood poisoning. I think we'll get him into a doctor as soon as he's rested.
Oh, shall I send for one?
Oh, no, no. I'll have a taxi call round for him in an hour or so. But I'll tell you what you could do for me.
Yes?
There's some blood on his shirt.
Oh, I'll sponge it off.
Thank you so much. Here it is.
I'll have it back inside the hour.
Oh, that's very kind of you.
Not at all.
Terrible business, wasn't it? And to think it could happen in England. Terrible. Well, I'd better get back inside, I suppose. I'll collect the shirt from you later.
All right.
Julie?
Oh, Pete. Did they catch the man yet?
No, he got clean away.
Well, that's bad luck.
Maybe. What was that Cora Donovan gave you?
Oh, her brother's shirt. Wants the blood sponged off it, that's all.
No, can I see?
Surely. Yeah. Find out anything about her?
No. It's strange.
Well, perhaps she's in the clear. After all, it was her brother.
These are all blood stains on the shirt.
What do you mean?
Well, that bullet grazed him only a little time ago. But these are old bloodstains.
I don't understand.
Neither do I. But I'm beginning to get that vague, uneasy feeling. Well, there's something wrong here.
I'll say there is. There's just been an attempt on the marshal's life.
Has there?
Pete, what's the matter with you? You saw the assassination attempt.
I saw some bullets flying around, fired by a hidden marksman who must have known he was too far away to have a hope in Hades of hitting Marshal Prakatis.
What?
Julie, I've got a horrible feeling that the whole thing was a setup.
How could it be?
Well, the people that are gained by the Marshal's death are specialists in the art of political murder. They don't fool around. They must have known that that little fracas wouldn't work.
Well, then why did they do it?
Diversionary tactics.
You're just talking in riddles.
Look, Julie, to all intents and purposes, there was an unsuccessful attempt to kill the Marshal, right?
Right.
Okay, it failed. So the security boys can now relax.
It's unlikely that anyone would try again.
Yeah, and maybe that's what the opposition wants us to think.
Well, at least the security men will be watching for another sniper.
That's right. But only an amateur would try and shoot down the marshal. And the opposition aren't amateurs. No, I think there'll be another attempt, and darn soon. And I think it'll come from inside this house.
Oh, Pete, surely not. I mean... Well, everyone here is above suspicion.
Except Cora and Jack Donovan.
But
especially Jack Donovan. If he was wounded before the shooting started, and judging by those bloodstains he was, he wanted to make it look as though he was shot in order to divert suspicion from himself.
All right, Troy. Now, I've gone along with you on this crazy hunch of yours, and now I'm beginning to lose patience. I assure you that Donovan isn't armed. He submitted to being searched quite cheerfully. We didn't even find a penknife on him.
Oh.
And he's here at Wallace's invitation.
Yes, yes, yes. And he's Cora Donovan's brother. So he's exempt from suspicion, I suppose?
Oh, don't make trouble, Troy.
It's my middle name, remember, Inspector? Look, what do we know about the Donovans?
They've been checked out very carefully, and neither of them have police records.
Of course they haven't. Look, these aren't hoodlums or petty criminals.
No, they're friends of a very important diplomat.
Oh, and so that gives them carte blanche?
Look, I'm going to get Colonel Llewellyn to remove you. Troy, you're a darn nuisance around here.
Well, you don't think there was anything phony about that assassination attempt?
No, I do not. Those bullets wounded Donovan. He wasn't far behind the marshal.
Donovan wasn't hit.
Oh. I suppose that graze on his arm was a figment of everyone's imagination.
Inspector, did you see the wound?
No.
Neither did I. But I did see his shirt afterwards, and there were no fresh bloodstains on it. I'll bet you your pension that the wound was several hours old, Inspector. It was inflicted before he came to this house.
Pete, they've gone.
What?
Cora and Jack Donovan just left in a taxi.
Oh,
she said
no.
She was taking him to see a doctor to get his arm dressed properly.
Well, Troy?
Oh... What do you mean, well, Troy?
Well, it seems as though you owe some apologies round the place.
Do I?
Oh, well, after all, Cora and Jack Donovan can hardly be expected to make an attempt to kill the marshal when they're no longer here, can they?
I still didn't like it. Oh, I'm under no illusions about my fallibility, but I still sensed that there was something badly wrong. Okay, so Cora and Jack Donovan were out of the picture, but I still believe that Marshal Prakatis' life was still in danger. And it was my guess that the danger still lay from within. Then, about half an hour after the Donovans had left, Inspector Caswell received an urgent phone call from Colonel Llewellyn, and suddenly the whole picture changed.
Oh, good grief.
What's the trouble, Inspector?
I hate to have to say this, but there's just the possibility that you may have been right after all, Troy.
How come?
Colonel Llewellyn supports your theory that those sniper's bullets might just have been a diversionary tactic.
Ah.
The Foreign Office have just been rechecking on Jack Donovan.
And?
Long time ago, he was involved in some sort of political demonstration.
A sympathizer with the opposition?
Yeah, something like that.
And he could still be involved with them?
Oh, it's possible.
Well, I'm not going to say I told you so.
No, anyway, he's gone now.
Oh, and so you think the danger's past?
The marshal's all right.
For the time being.
What do you mean?
Donovan could have already done his dirty work.
Poison?
Oh, no, that's too risky. It'd have to be something more definite.
Such as?
A time bomb.
Oh, no.
That's nice and dramatic and noisy. It's just what they want.
Troy...
You better send somebody out after the Donovans.
Llewellyn's already done that. They can't be found.
9:45.
Could go off any time.
What's the marshal's routine? What are his habits?
He always goes to bed early. That's no secret.
Yeah, but what time?
Always on the dot of 10, no matter where he is.
Okay, so our friends know that he'd be in his bedroom from 10 onwards. Right, so tonight he's going to have to alter his routine. Now, you tell him...
No, we can't do that.
What?
He mustn't know. We suspect that there's going to be another attempt. Llewellyn says we're balancing on a diplomatic tightrope.
Oh, for...
Well, the marshal is angry about the first attempt. If he gets to hear...
Jumping Jehoshaphat, Inspector. He might die.
Until we know for sure. Until they bring back Donovan.
Donovan may never be found.
I can't do a thing.
Oh, okay, so we searched this house for a bomb.
It could be hidden in a million places.
Then we'd better hurry up and get started. If my hunch is right, we might only have a quarter of an hour.
Nothing, Troy. Absolutely nothing, and it's 10:00.
Oh, you've searched the marshal's room?
Yes, thoroughly. He's gone into retire now.
A bomb must be somewhere near that bedroom.
Of course, we're still not certain.
Well, I am. It's a bomb, all right. Something that can become world headlines. Now, if the marshal was poisoned, the cause of his death could be covered up. But you can't cover up an explosion. It's too messy and too noisy.
Go to the devil with diplomatic tightropes. Let's tell the marshal.
Hey, wait a minute. What's that over there on the corner?
Oh, the marshal's briefcase. Oh, that's all right. It's been checked. Contains nothing but papers.
Yeah. Yeah, of course, a briefcase would be the ideal container for a bomb. A briefcase.
I just told you.
I'll swear he had his briefcase upstairs with him only 10 minutes ago. That one. Or one very much like it.
Well, I assure you he doesn't have two of them.
Well, he didn't have, but he may have now and not know a thing about it.
What?
Hold on a second. What happened to Donovan's briefcase?
He had one?
When he came in. One of your men who was helping him through the front door was carrying it. And Donovan didn't take it with him when he left with Cora. I watched them go.
That's it, then. The bomb was in Donovan's briefcase.
And it was a black one, just like that.
And the marshal has it now.
In his bedroom.
Well, here goes for the jackpot.
Oh, Pete, don't go up there.
I'm the only guy around here who's not a civil servant. And someone's got to save the poor old inspector's pension, now, haven't they? The rest of you better take cover, just in case.
Pete, come back!
Everyone, down on the floor.
Oh, Pete.
He's gone in.
Pete.
That explosion came from outside.
Open it.
Is there a double brandy in the house?
Oh, Pete. He's safe.
Troy, what the devil happened?
Oh, the other briefcase was there, all right. Large as life, right beside the marshal's bed. So I grabbed a hold of it and slung it out the window.
The marshal?
Oh, he's okay. But he must have thought I was a madman.
Oh, Pete, Pete. I thought...
Now, everything's hunky-dory now, honey bun. You just trust to Troy's hunches in future.
What on earth did the marshal say when you barged into his room?
Well, I'll tell you what he didn't say.
Walk softly, Peter Troy.
They never found Cora and Jack Donovan, though occasionally Scotland Yard hears of them through Interpol. It seems that they're roaming around the world, never able to rest in one place very long. You see, they're being chased by a group of people they fear even more than the police. A group of people who don't take kindly to having their agents make mistakes. Or having assassination attempts misfire. And Martin Wallace is a much wiser gent now. He'll never again be taken in by a chattering, scatterbrained female. Not until next time, anyway. As for Marshal Prakatis, it's comforting to know that he thinks well of us, or at least our country. Because I never did learn the translation of what he shouted at me as I clattered into his room. But off the record, he wears the duckiest style in nightshirts you ever did see.
This is the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.